First, though, our top story tonight. Tony Abbott is now officially our Prime Minister. He said while it was a day of ceremony, it was also a day of action, and he certainly meant it. The new PM has already sacked senior public servants and overhauled the bureaucracy. Mr Abbott also ordered legislation to repeal the carbon tax, as well as his controversial border protection plan is being implemented. Shortly, we'll speak to a former Defence Force chief who says Mr Abbott's Stop the Boats policy is doomed to fail. But first, this report from Matt Moran.
Surrounded by the first family, Australia's 28th Prime Minister is sworn in.
I, Anthony John Abbott, do swear that I will well and truly serve the people of Australia in the office of Prime Minister.
The new PM's parents beamed with pride, Mr Abbott taking the opportunity to outline his government's priorities.
We are determined to honour our commitments to scrap the carbon tax, to stop the boats, to get the budget under control.
Advance Australia Fair.
Warren Truss is now Deputy Prime Minister.
Congratulations.
Julie Bishop has become our first female Foreign Minister. And just in case you missed the controversy, the only woman in Cabinet.
Congratulations to you. Thank you for your important day in your life and in our country's life.
Big Bibles helped make a very formal event fun at times.
I thought you knew my handwriting from many years going by.
It's deteriorating.
Our new Treasurer Joe Hockey brought his family along for the special day and enjoyed some playtime. Greg Hunt, the new Environment Minister, went one step further with his daughter.
Is this a special witness?
It is indeed.
With the class photo done, Mr Abbott gathered his ministry for its first meeting.
We have won the trust of the people. Now, over coming weeks, months and years, we have to earn it.
One notable person missing from Cabinet is Sophie Mirabella. She released a statement today conceding defeat in the seat of Indi.
I will do my very best to be the very best member for Indi that we have ever had.
In the seat of Fairfax, the count continues. Clive Palmer leads by just 3 votes. And while we wait, Mr Abbott has already started his public service clean-out, sacking 3 department heads. In addition, Treasury boss Martin Parkinson is set to leave after next year's budget.
Sacking people, not promoting women, that's not the best start I've ever seen.
Operation Sovereign Borders, which includes turning back asylum seeker boats, is well underway. Tony Abbott is expected to visit Jakarta later this month. Matt Moran, 10 Eyewitness News.
Well, clearly the first order of business for Tony Abbott and his new government is to, in their words, turn back the boats, stop the boats. Joining us for more on this is the retired Admiral Chris Barry, who was heavily involved when the Howard government was in power in dealing with asylum seeker boat arrivals. Chris Barry, thanks for talking to us tonight. You've been incredibly critical today of Tony Abbott's policy. Explain precisely why.
When the vessel is sighted, because we have a declared policy that we're going to turn boats back, I think the people smugglers will ensure those boats are disabled to an extent where that policy will not be able to be implemented. At least what they will do is disable the engines and the navigable apparatus on the vessel, and that is certainly what they used to do in 2001. At worst, what these people smugglers will do is sink the boat or set fire to the boat or a combination of both.
The broader context here, though, is that that is one plank, if you like, of a broader policy platform. Is it not possible that if other changes are effective and more boats are deterred from travelling in the first place, that this might be potentially a more workable scenario?
If the boats don't approach Australia, of course it's going to be workable. But I just don't see how you're going to put in place a whole host of arrangements to interrupt this business model. For example,
so do you not
I've heard
think then that Tony Abbott's proposal for interrupting the business model before the boats actually leave is going to work?
Well, I've heard a proposal that we'll buy up these kind of boats and therefore take them away from the people smugglers. The sort of metaphor that puts in my mind is like, you know, buying up all the stocks of illegal drugs before the criminals get to sell them on the street. You know, I just don't see how that's going to work. And, of course, we'll be mounting those operations and those purchases in other people's countries. How would we feel about it if somebody came here and started to buy up all our boats for this kind of purpose.
Can we be a little more specific about your concern, though, in terms of the safety? Is it just the safety of the asylum seekers that you're concerned about, or also Australian military personnel?
I think it's both. One of the serious concerns you've got to have is when asylum seekers are in the water, fleeing a sinking boat or a burning boat or both, our people, who I think have done a terrifically outstanding job, I'm very proud of what they've been able to do in difficult circumstances, they will turn from being interceptors to rescuers. That means they're going to jump into the water. That means they're going to rescue people who are drowning. I just hope none of them lose their lives in the execution of the operation.
And do you think that that's likely to happen?
No, I don't think it's likely to happen, but it could happen. I go back to the fundamental principle of the operation in 2001. No one, not an asylum seeker, and none of ours, should lose their life in the execution of this operation. That's why I think this is poor policy.
All right. Admiral Chris Barry, we'll leave it there. Thank you very much for talking to us tonight.
Thanks very much, Hamish.